that low is now because I understand we're going to have a little picture take session for the door, which reach a little individually, but thank you all for being here. And you probably heard a rumor to the effect that Ryan from Nakasone is coming here. I will be talking to him, and I recognize the problem that we have. And I would like from you, and I'm sure I will receive your very candid views, and I would like to have you speak plainly with us. I'd like to have all the information and input that you could give me. And with that, I'll turn it over to Ambassador Brock.
Mr. President, we had a brief session before coming in to talk to you and sort of laid out two or three fundamental things we'd like to ask the participants to address. Primarily, as I told them, to give you something of a flavor of the complexity of the relationship and the depth of the problem, because it is serious and it is very real. And we've encouraged all of these individuals to be very frank and speak their mind, as you would expect that, and no less. Maybe we could start with a problem that seems to affect everybody, whether they're exporters or importers, and that's the problem that Lee Morgan has brought to George Schultz and Don Reed and others here in Mac.
I think it's probably
it's not meaty, but I know change this morning with friends from the United Kingdom and all making a different proposal. But I certainly don't believe that we should retreat from our position. We were just talking in here. I think we do have to be interested in hearing your views on what has happened now since the kind of interim proposal has been made by a couple of our allies. But the latest Soviet thing, I think, is that we've got a job over here to do public relations wise. The latest Soviet proposal, but somehow it is fair for them to have over 1,000 warheads aimed at the targets in Western Europe, but it would be provocative and unfair for us to have even a single missile that could get to them in the same period of time. And that somehow is us seeking a first strike capability. And it's utterly ridiculous that I think it offers us an opportunity to finally mobilize some interest in public opinion on our side. But this, of course, has to do with the INF thing and not with the, what you're negotiating.
Well, they are working.
Hello.
How are you?
Good to see you.
Hi.
How are you doing?
Good morning.
Good.
Good
to see you.
Huh?
How are you?
Good.
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 Nice to meet you.
How are you?
Mr. President.
Paul. Yes.
Paul.
Good to
see
you.
Hi.
Nice to see you.
I won't go all the way around.
Good to see you again.
I know.
Good to see you.
How are you?
I know.
Hi.
How are you?
Subject. Well, please. Who did I interrupt?
I was finished.
Well, listen, I'm honored to be meeting here with you on this particular anniversary day. And I remember when many of us met here some time ago, and I urged that we see if we couldn't unite behind one proposal, and we did to a certain extent fail, and I want to bring up something, if it hasn't been brought up already, that's going to present a problem. We barely lost by about one vote in tabling on our friend Henry Hyde's proposal with regard to federal funding of abortion. And this time, we're faced with a difficulty. They have changed the rules, and the rules committee has a Democratic majority in the House. And according to that, now there will no longer be a chance for Hyde-type writing being put on an appropriation bill. And we're going to have to work very hard. But we want to get that, and I think it's an important thing to get to stem the tide. But if you don't mind, I would like and then hear from all of you. I keep kicking around in my head with another idea that's a little different than many of the things that have been proposed. It wouldn't require an amendment to the Constitution at all. But some time ago, when the East Committee was having the hearings, When Life Begins, was treated by the press as, after the lengthy hearings and all the experts on both sides who had spoken, that they came to no conclusion. Well, in my view, that was a conclusion. If you said this before, you know, if you came upon a body and you couldn't determine whether it was alive or dead, you wouldn't bury it, you would out.
for life until somebody could prove it was dead. And if after all that testimony, they cannot make that decision, what would happen if we all centered our activities on either establishing that it is alive or but saying that if they can't establish that it isn't alive, then you have to opt for life. And I remember, I don't know whether I told you this before, but in California, it was a strange thing when the whole matter of abortion came up. And it isn't true that I supported abortion on demand. It is true that I got a little deceived on the health issue by the in the area of psychiatry and did not realize that how loosely they would interpret the law. But at the time, there was a very strange dichotomy there. Not too long before that, a man had beaten his common law wife so severely that the child she was carrying was born dead. And the California legislature unanimously voted that any crime in the future of that kind, the man who administered the beating or mistreated any woman to cause the death of her unborn child, would be charged with murder. Now, how can we recognize that it is murder to mistreat someone and cause the death of an unborn child, or to be born dead, and then turn around and say that it's all right for someone simply for their personal convenience to take the life of that unborn child surgically, and that doesn't violate, to me, the Constitution that guarantees us life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? Well, unless they can prove that isn't a life, then the Constitution already protects that unborn child. And I just throw this out to see if there's any merit in us researching or studying this as a possible approach.
If you could dissolve the Supreme Court, it's probably good.
Well, I wonder, since they haven't been able to arrive at a decision on this, could even the Supreme Court rule? And there it is.
Dr. Jefferson.
How are you?
Mr. President, so nice to be here. So happy to see you.
But I just wondered if we might, but of course I still believe that we're stronger if we unite on one thing, and I should think this administration will do everything we can to help, to be supportive of this. But to look into this thing, is the burden of proof on us or is it on them? We have children born extremely prematurely who live. I've seen myself in a hospital, one that only weighed 2.5 pounds because it was born so prematurely. For those of you who haven't heard, and then I will quit and let this discussion go on because I know time is limited. The legislator who was introducing the abortion bill in California is now a congressman, and he was a state senator then, and he was in a debate with a doctor regarding when life begins or when is the unborn a human being. And the doctor was showing him photos, as I saw Dr. Jefferson showing him, I suppose, x-ray photos, and at various periods in the time of pregnancy. And the doctor was asking him in the debate if this was a human being, and he kept saying no. And finally, he'd gotten up to pretty far along in the pregnancy and showed him a picture and said, is this a human being? And the legislator, now a congressman, said no, and the doctor said, I have just shown you a picture of your son. And that son was then 8 years old going to school with my son. But I just throw this out for our consideration.
Well, Mr. President, we may not be in perfect agreement on exactly what approach to take on the constitutional amendment.